fine time, 6 o'clock. So, I want us, aloha.
Aloha.
Welcome to the April 2015 Natural Farming Meeting. Thank you for coming out. Tonight we have, we're gonna talk about Oriental herbal nutrient and some other medicinal tinctures and medicine and natural farming type stuff. But before we get to that part, I want to open it up for any announcements that people have and or comments or suggestions or some story that you want to tell that's less than 2 minutes long.
Okay, everybody, okay, I'm going to tell you a story. I'm going to tell you two stories. One,
you can have more than 2 minutes.
One not so good, one good. About 2.5 months ago, you guys all saw it in the newspaper, what happened in Waianae on the pigs. There was an outbreak of a disease that they thought was the disease in Iowa that was killing hundreds, maybe even millions of baby pigs out there. And they thought it was the same disease that came to Hawaii. And they thought it came in from mainland pigs coming to Hawaii. A farmer taking his pigs to the slaughterhouse, then getting on his clothes, and he take it back to his farm, and that's all they thought. The thing got transmitted. So the DNA came back, they found out that wasn't the strain that was in Iowa, but it was a close brother to that, and it wasn't as virulent. They went back into the files, and they found something like this happened in 1980, and the pigs cured themselves. Right now, the pigs have cured themselves, which is good news. Now, here's the sad news, okay? When they went out there, they found the disease. They had to quarantine every piggery within 3 miles of that infected piggery. The Department of Agriculture thought that they had it covered. When they went out there to isolate the pigs or quarantine the piggeries, for every one piggery that they knew, there were 3 new ones that they haven't. So everybody raising pigs in Waianae, they never know that. Well, anyway, one of the piggeries was an idealized piggery. Okay, and the regulator went there to quarantine the piggery, and the piggery was negative, and somehow the producer and the so-called regulator got into a verbal argument, okay? I'm telling everybody in this room, we are not beyond the county, state, and federal laws, okay? You still have to abide by that. An idealist piggery is our best management practice to alleviate the problems of these laws, okay? But we are not the law. The pig farmer told the state regulator, the feds approved this, so the federal law is better than your state law. You get off my farm and I will kick you off. So I had a big fight. State regulator looked at him and he said, okay, your piggery, I notice you do not have a 6-inch concrete and you do not have a plastic liner on the bottom of your piggery, which puts you in violation of the Clean Water Act, which is a federal mandate for the state. I can cite you on that. Second thing is, your pig farm does not have a completed nutrient management plan, which I can cite you for that, which you are in violation with the Department of Health. I notice you're feeding garbage. You do not have a permit to pick up garbage, which means you are in violation with the Department of Agriculture. I notice that you do not have a permit to cook garbage, which means that you are in violation with the Food Safety Inspection Services, which is a federal law. I noticed that on your building, you do not have a general excise tax, which means license, which you are in violation with the state laws to do business in the state of Hawaii. And since you don't pay taxes, the general excise tax, I'm assuming that you do not pay taxes on your farm. So you tell me if you are legal or you're not legal. Because you cause so much problem, I will cite this farm today, and you need to make all the corrections, or else I'll shut you down. Okay? So right now I got an irate pig farmer in Waianae that's trashing natural farming, saying that the teacher he learned from never teach me that. So I'm telling everybody that teaches classes or learns about natural farming or tells people about natural farming, make sure that they follow the rules, okay? Because the Department of Health called me and he told me, if CGNF continues to teach classes that are illegal to the laws in Hawaii, we will not be able to teach classes. It seems like this guy got very animated, probably even went as far as to throw some blows with the regulator. And the regulator was just there to evaluate his farm, to tell him the farm is under quarantine until we figure out what is wrong with the pigs that was an uninfected farm. Okay? So what I'm saying is we are not parted from any of the laws in the state. We still got our bylaw. Okay? Now here's the good news. I just got back from Seattle. Okay? And my job was to go up there and promote a best management practice for the small family farm. As I went through Washington State, I found out that if you have only one cow, you need a comprehensive nutrient management plan. If you have one pig, you need a comprehensive management plan. The comprehensive management plan requires you to do the proper way to dispose of your manure. In Washington, they use composting. The way they do composting in Washington, I was surprised. They got automatic machines that actually mix the green waste with the manure. The machines are all computerized. It's got temperature gauges in there, so it measures the temperature. It also oxygenates the compost. And they told me they can make the compost in 7 days. And I looked at them, I said, for real? They said, yeah. So we went to see the facility. The facility is immaculate. We got a nice building, everything is working, pulling out all the scientific data on the site. It is great. The question I asked the owner, how much that machine cost you? Oh, $110,000. I look at him, I go, ooh, for that price, I can put in a 50 cell piggery in a big oven. Huh? I say, you come to the meeting at the waste management seminars at the Sierra West End, and you come learn what we're doing in Hawaii. So he came, and then it was my turn to get up. Everybody at that meeting, they thought, digesters? They got 10,000 sows, 3,000 sows, 1,000 pigs, or they thought large-scale composting with the machines. Okay. I get up there and I talk about idealist piggeries for small family farms. And the room got kind of plenty of people inside. And I hear people snickering, laughing. Listen to this. This is all bull, you know? And three quarters of the way through the talk, people started to stand up and walk out. And a lady went stand up in the back, and she was from Portland, Oregon. Her name is Sally McGregor. She says, you know, a lot of these things sounds like pie in the sky, but I'm Sally McGregor, and I'm from Portland, Oregon. And I've been to a lot. I've seen those pigs that we gave. And what he's talking about is true, and it's totally amazing what the people in Hawaii have adopted and has brought to us in Washington. And by the way, you know who I am? You're gonna look at it again. I'm the liaison for NRCS for the EQUIP program for the Western section. I gave the number approval for the PIGRI to be a best management practice throughout the whole United States. Okay? In the back, another guy stand up. Well, I'm Eric Turner from Florida. I don't know where that. He says, wait, I used to work for Farm Pilot Project Coordination. I thought to myself, wow, that's the guy who gave us the seed money. He said this, the thing works because we gave the expansion money for what Mike is talking about, the canning farm, and the money to fund Michael Hubble. So he knew which farms was in Hawaii. After that, I was like the Grammy winner. I gave away. I had a stack of papers like this. All my business cards were gone. I had to take names and numbers so I could send people off. This thing would revolutionize what is doing in throughout the whole United States. We went up to the Indian reservations, and it looks like they're going to be doing some. They got approval to build one piggery in Spokane, Washington. So this thing is going to take off. So you guys be sure that when you talk to people, make sure you tell them follow the state, county, and federal laws. And this thing is a blessing for us because now we can satisfy them. And those laws are coming to compliance with it. So don't be surprised if some of you teachers get called to go do workshops in the mainland. Because we have all you guys name and phone number. And it's going to be something that's going to happen in the near future. So that's the good news. So, go ahead, Jimmy. Thank you.
Our little bee goddess, Jen Rasmussen, down in Kapoho, finally wrote this wonderful little book, Intuitive Treatment, Free Tropical Beekeeping. She's just great. It's a wonderful little introduction to what she does, why she does it, how she does it. We had these up at the Honokana Seed Exchange. These are left over. They're $20 a piece. I'll go to Jen if you're interested. Sweet little book. Really nice.
Yeah, she's great.
Mm-hmm.
I have another announcement. Zoping came from China, and he will be here in this building May 1st to the 3rd, leading a seminar. He worked for 7 years in a Medicinal hospital that became so famous that the government shut it down. They were treating, well, they don't say treating, they were teaching 7,000 people per day, and the government got very, very nervous because they shut down another Qigong master, and they shut this treatment center down. And now, what has happened is the teachers in the center have gone back home, and they open up little centers, and the government has told them they could have no more than 50 students per day. So that's what they're working on. And he is in town, and he will do a workshop. He'll be $275 for 3 days and in this building. Peng Ming, who's the founder of this qigong, is under house arrest. But it's not, it's, he's free to travel in the city that he is, not outside of that city. And he can see most people that he wants to see, except I think if foreigners come in, then there's a guard there listening to everything he talks to the foreigners. But he's using qigong strictly for self-healing. And the reason why the numbers rose to 7,000, a lot of people who are cancer patients, who the Western medicine had given up because they were in fourth stage cancer, got healed in this qigong method. So if you're interested, call the number here, I'll leave it here, and sign yourself up. If you have any more questions, I'd be glad to answer. And I think she took it, so she can also answer some questions.
It's really good. And you can use it to heal plants and animals, all kinds of stuff. So it has appropriate.
I just wanted to introduce myself. This is the second meeting that I've attended to. My name is Chris Hardenbrook. A year ago, I worked for the county planning department, house geographer, cartographer, and their GIS. And I retired in April and moved out of my place in Gilo up to Curtis Town, where I have a 6-acre farm that was neglected. So I'm renovating the lands and starting some chickens and finding tropical fruit and looking for ways to not buy fertilizer, naturally develop the land up good, so that in 5 years' time I hope to be able to just lie on my back and let the fruit fall into my mouth. So I just want to say thank you for having this group, and cheers to us.
Who is this your first time here? So I'll have my email up here. If you want to sign up for our email list, someone will take care of that for me, right? So see that person. And I have one announcement to make of many. But I'll just stick with one, and that's the Farmers Union also meets here on the third Tuesday, and it's a great group, a statewide organization, and actually a national organization, one of the oldest organizations of farmers around, and the idea with that is to get critical mass people into the Farmers Union, so that when they go up for legislation to, like, for like getting piggeries approved and these types of things, we can come up and say, you know, hey, we're here with the Farmers Union, we'd like this, and we have 20,000 members across the state. And then that gives us some clout. So I really encourage you to join the Farmers Union. It's $50 for an individual, it's $100 for a farm. And you can have 4 people sign up under that. So essentially it's $25 if you plan correctly. We're trying to get that started. I'm their treasurer. If you're interested in more political stuff, go there. This happens every second Tuesday, and that's the question. So, all right. Any other announcements? Crickets.
I'll take the emails if you. I'll make a list of emails if anyone
yes.
wants to sign up for the
emails. Yeah, please see Lehua. So I think what we're gonna do tonight is I will go through this presentation on OHN, and then after that we will eat and have time to talk story.
get to know each other, especially if this is your first time here. There's lots of really experienced people. If you're experienced, raise your hand. Yeah. There's lots of humble people here. So, that's good. All right, so, aloha, my name is Drake. I've been doing this natural farming for a while, about 7 years now, and I would like to proudly say that I have not been sick for 5 years. So the only time I did get sick in the past 7 years that I've been a natural farmer is when I went to Missouri and I didn't have my natural farming things with me and I was exposed to some really cold weather and ended up getting pretty sick for a couple weeks there. But in basically the past 7 years of natural farming, I haven't been sick. And so I'm here tonight to share one of the best medicinal parts of natural farming with you. And this is my email, drake@naturalfarminghawaii.net. This is also the website that I post all of this information that we collect here too. Just so you know, I'm video and audio recording, so be quiet with your words. And let's get started. So basically in tonight's presentation, I'm going to talk about the definition of what a tincture is, a traditional OHN recipe, which I'll get into what OHN means during the definition, the recommended use of these tinctures and these medicines, properties of why you would want a tincture or make these, some other tinctures besides the things I have here, and a suggested workflow that I got here last time that I thought was cool, so I mixed that in. So that's what we're going to do this evening. Start with this definition here, which is a tincture. So has anyone tinctured before? Okay, four of us here, so that's good. A tincture is dissolving things in alcohol so that they become more available to your body or to what you're applying this medicine to. Alcohol is a really strong thing that can solubilize things that otherwise wouldn't be able to enter into your cells. So tonight, the traditional recipe of what I'm talking about is OHN, and I should probably have written out what the acronym stands for.
It says on the right hand side.
Yeah, but let me just. OHN stands for Oriental Herbal Nutrient. So if you notice here, I start with garlic, ginger, licorice, cinnamon, and angelica. And these are the five herbs that are commonly prescribed in Oriental medicine for various ailments. And they are kind of like the bedrock of medicine. So when we make OHN, what we do is we tincture all of these and we combine them into one thing that we call Oriental Herbal Nutrient. The basic common denominator between all of these things is that they're really good for digestion. And they also tend to have the element of fire in them. So you'll notice as you drink it, it may get your belly start to heat up and get going. So what I want to do is to send around this bottle, and this is not quite this here, because I made it a little bit differently, but this is what I'm using as my OHN. And so you're able to just use this little dropper here, give yourself a nice dose. And so we'll just pass this along and go for it. It is bound with alcohol, so if you have objections to alcohol, joke. And if you're allergic to anything, please don't die.
How is that different
from what you're drinking there is garlic, ginger, and turmeric. So instead of including licorice, cinnamon, and angelica, which I'll go over in this presentation, I just used what I could get here locally available really easily.
Did you use equal parts?
And they are equal parts in there. So to make this, I'm going to go through our traditional recipe. There's steps of having wet ingredients, like fresh garlic. Sometimes you have dry ingredients, like dried cinnamon. And so I'm going to go over those two methods of preparing those, and then we'll go over how the alcohol is actually tinctured that out. So in the preparation of our fresh ingredients, so when I'm starting with my garlic and ginger and turmeric, this is the recipe that I'm following here. And so what I do is I just crush and mash the material into about quarter size, so that it has a lot of surface area, it's pretty small, it's not blended, it's not extremely pulverized, it's just kind of just to make enough surface area. You either cut it really thin, or in the case of garlic, just get a big rock and just mash it, and then you'll have your starting material. Once you have that material, you mix it with 1/3 brown sugar by weight. So what you started with your material, weigh that out, mix in your brown sugar, and then you want to fill your vessel, which I tend to use 1/2-gallon mason jars because they're nice, my hand can fit inside, really easy to work with. You want to use glass or clay.
I forgot about that.
You don't really want to use plastic here, because the plastic will also get into your medicine. So if you're trying to use it to heal you, plastic doesn't really have that many good things for you. And then you're going to leave it out on a countertop with just a breathable lid over it. And in the next 3 to 5 days, your garlic, ginger, turmeric, these materials you're working with will ferment. And so the microorganisms will begin to digest and break down this material. And when you're working with garlic and you have like excessive garlic peels, you don't have to put in that. But some of the peels is fine. The peels are decent to put in. Just, you know, like you'll get so much that you can discard the real excess of your garlic peels.
But
yes?
You're cutting up garlic or ginger and you put it in 2-quart mason jar. How much material do you want for 2/3 full?
Probably like 3 big pieces of ginger, and then maybe like maybe like 20 cloves of garlic. Not cloves, but bolts. 20 bolts of garlic.
But you keep them separate. You do the ginger in one, you do the garlic in another, and then you combine them.
Yes, and that's a great point. If you notice in this beginning picture where I had all these happening individually, I'm keeping them by themselves. So I'm going to do a garlic and a garlic by itself, a ginger by itself,
And so I'm not going to mix my garlic and ginger together. I'm going to do them in their own individual. So at the very end of my process, I'll combine them all. But in this intermediate step, it's important that when we're doing the extraction with alcohol, that they're separate.
So you've got about a quarter to a third of the material, and then you add the alcohol.
Haven't gone to the alcohol yet, but I will get to that step.
Oh, you got two thirds full of the jar, in the jar of just the material.
Yes. So just the material, no liquids, nothing has entered this. The only thing we're working with here is our garlic and ginger and our sugar. And we're packing that into our jar, two thirds full.
Does there have to be sugar? Honey, molasses, some other sweeteners?
It's another great question. So in natural farming, sometimes I'll say sugar. What I'm specifically referring to is brown sugar. Not sugar in the raw, not white sugar, I'm brown sugar. And brown sugar, it really helps with osmotic pressure to pull out nutrients, as well as really helps to feed the microorganisms with balanced nutrients. Like if you have honey, sell your honey, buy brown sugar. So if you are starting with dry ingredients like cinnamon that you bought from China, or angelica, or those things, what you want to do is you'll take those dry ingredients, you'll put it into your container that's two-thirds full, and then you cover it with the cheapest beer you can find. And what that's going to do is that the beer is already fermented. So as the beer starts to enter your material, it rehydrates it, but it also ferments to open up to make the material more available for our next step. See, yeah, you can use any kind of beer, but the cheaper the better. And then you let that stand the same as your fermentation, which is your 3 to 5 days.
I have a question.
Are you covering that too for 3 to 5 days?
Breathable lid. Yep, breathable lid over your jar. Yep. Yes.
Why cheaper beer?
Why?
More medicinal.
If you were to like brew your own beer to make your own, like if you're making super high quality medicines and you're gonna brew your own, but in most cases, then you get fresh cinnamon and all those things.
Yes. I thought it was because it would probably be more sugar, because it's cheaper, like a faster, cheaper alcohol is usually like ferments. They use a cheaper sugar and it ferments faster. And that's why you use cheaper beer.
That's also a really good consideration. I'm not sure when I, as I understood this, yeah, just like, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Don't waste your
beer versus malt liquor, just beer. I can't read the. It doesn't matter.
Oh, that's high gravity, so I don't know what that really is. I have no idea what that product is really.
It's cheap beer.
Yeah. So typically when I made OHN the traditional way, it was hard to get the cinnamon, the licorice, and the angelica. So we bought those from Chinatown, and they came in dry packages. So we just rehydrated them with some high gravities. And is that clear up to this? So at this point, we've got our fresh ingredients that have been fermented. We've got our dry ingredients that have been rehydrated with something that's already fermented. Got that action happening. So now we're going to move on to this stage of alcohol extraction. And so with your material, what you want to do is to then open it up and cover it with vodka until you get to the very brim of the vessel. So to fill up your vessel to the very top. And you can use vodka. In Korea, they use soju, which is distilled rice wine. I think you can use pretty much any alcohol.
I've done it before where I've made my own Everclear with a still from cane juice and then used that. So 40% alcohol, about 35% is the minimum amount you need of alcohol content, but you can also ferment with higher alcohol contents. So 80%, which is like the Everclear, and it's still going to be effective. Now that you've added the alcohol into your container, you want to seal it airtight because the alcohol will evaporate out if you don't seal it airtight. And for the next 7 to 10 days, you stir your material around. Some people shake it, but shaking is less superior than stirring. And Master Cho went into detail on that. Yes?
Okay, so I'm in the middle. I'm in the beginning of the OHN process. And so what I thought, I haven't been stirring it, but I've been, I have half-gallon jars, and I'm taking it, turning it upside down, and turning it slowly.
Well done.
Does that pass?
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank
you. So after you, the 10 days has elapsed, step 4 here is to take your material and to drain it off into a separate container. So the garlic's going in with the garlic, ginger's going with the ginger, we're not mixing those. And if you want to take that material, you can now ferment it, or you can repeat that alcohol extraction 4 more times. So to continue this, so to get more bang for your buck, if you bought all this garlic, and you can do an alcohol extraction up to 4 times on it and still get great potency. So to do that, what you do is once you've poured all your liquid off, you then pour back in to your material until you filled it up 1/3 with the liquid. So your material will be probably, you know, still up around your 2/3 line. It might compress down, but don't worry too much about that. You fill it back up with the liquid to 1/3. And this is to preserve your fermentation that you've got, and you're adding a little bit of the liquid back, and this helps to keep that the cells and everything open. And then you can fill it with more alcohol, more 40% alcohol, back up to the brim. And you can repeat this to go back to then sealing it and waiting again for 7 to 10 days, stirring it every day. And then you'll drain off the liquid. So again, I had my first pour off, and I have my garlic there. I poured back 1/3 into it. Now when I go to do my next pour off, I pour it into that jar that I've got my pour off, mix that around, and then from that jar, pour back in 1/3, and then repeat and fill it back up. So you're always taking your batch that you have that's been poured off, and then mixing your new pour offs into that and stirring that up and then adding it back in to keep this fermentation loop, or this extraction loop, open.
And you're keeping an airtight lid on your pour off jars?
Yes, yes. So once you've added the alcohol, it's always airtight.
So if you're using 4 ingredients, you're
going to
have 4 fermentation jars, 4 pour-off jars.
Yes. Yes. So that makes sense there, Ron?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. And so this can be repeated, yeah, like I said, 4 times through there.
Is this on the website?
This presentation specifically will be, not yet. And so, once we've done that for all of our ingredients, we've gone through all this process, now we're at the end. And this, again, is where I show combining all these into one. You always want to store the alcohol with the airtight lid, And you also want to try to keep it in the dark. That way the sun will break down your medicine if it's not kept in the dark. And before you use it, you want to make sure you shake it well, because it'll settle out. And you can store this. It's best to store it like in a closet where the temperature is not fluctuating too much. You can store it in the fridge if you want, but that's not necessary. And because this is bound with that much alcohol, this is pretty much preserved at that point. You can just let it. So, yes.
So after your 4 to 6 times that you use it over and over and over, do you ever just press out the mark, the last, you know, your herb at the very end?
I don't press things out. Just what I do is I put a screen over the top and I'll hang it upside down and leave it upside down for like half the day, and a lot of stuff will come out. And my material then, if I pressed it out, I'm not gonna get more than like a few drops out. With these materials, from what I found, like they really do, you know, by just gravity is really strong to pull the liquid out. If you're patient enough. And I'm not sure specifically on the OHN, but I know when we're doing other fermentation, we don't want to press it out, because same reason we don't want to blend our material before we start, because we want the stuff that's in the cell to stay in the cell. And if I'm mechanically pushing it out, the stuff that the alcohol brought out is the stuff that's bound with the alcohol. And then that's going to be my medicine. Whereas if I mechanically push it out, I'm getting other things that are coming out that maybe weren't bound with that alcohol. Make sense? So the recommended use of OHN, we got it, we stored it, we mixed it all together, is to dilute it 1 to 1,000. So this is a very potent ingredient. I think that's like less than 0.1% of dilution. And the nice thing about OHN is that when you make it, you'll tend to get a fair amount of it, especially if you do those 4 pour-offs. Because when I did it in a half gallon jar, each time I'm getting, you know, close to a half gallon of vodka off of it. It's not quite that much, but I'm getting a fair amount. So now I've combined all 5 of those, or all 6 of those, into this thing, and now I have a 5 gallon bucket full of OHN. And the cool thing is that every year I store it, and store it properly, it gets more potent and more powerful and more effective. So for every year old it gets, I have to dilute it more. So if it's 2 years old, 1 to 2,000. If it's 3 years old, 1 to 3,000. So by making it, you know, you make a whole bunch, you can potentially make like years worth, because the longer you store it, the less you have to use. So this material becomes very valuable. And if you look through Master Cho's recipes, it's used in every single one of them, I think, right? There's not a single recipe it's not used in. It's part of the basic maintenance spray, which consists of this OHN itself, vinegar, and a plant food. And that's what you would use in any case if you just want to do general maintenance to your plant. You know, putting the medicine out there, putting some food, and putting vinegar to kind of make nutrients flow and move. The reason it's included in every one is because it increases the potency and the absorbency of the other amendments. Like I said, the common denominator here was that they were good for digestion. So if you're putting something on your plant, it's digesting it through its outside. So it's helping it absorb this, and it's helping it digest better as it receives these nutrients. It can really help to boost a plant's immune system and its resilience in general. So if you're looking at your plant and you're like, oh, you know, I kind of want to, you know, it looks like it needs a little help here. This is one of the inputs to use, because all of those things, I guess it's on my next slide, but all of those things, I forgot what I was saying. if your plant is really looking sick though, like it's already being attacked by aphids and it's starting to die, just like you don't want to eat a whole bunch of food when you're not feeling so well, the plant also doesn't want to eat a whole lot. And so you want to kind of dilute a little more if your plant is sick. And that just helps it in general, like a little bit of nutrient, like, you know, you just want a sip of water when you're sick, can really take you a long way. Same with your plant. So dilute it 1 to 2,000 if your plant is sick, 1 to 1,500, 1 to 2,000. And that will help the plant just kind of bounce back. Just like when you tasted it here, it kind of gave you that little fire inside. It can kind of breathe a little light back into anything you apply it to.
That was undiluted?
Yes. Yeah, you got a strong root dose.
Are you applying it to the soil or are you spraying it on the plant?
Both. It directly onto the plant as a spray, and I got the dilutions are on the internet, but basically it's I can't recall this right now. So as a plant spray, essentially what you're trying to do is just make the leaf surface wet. So if you have your Mr. Sprayer and you can spray it on, you just want to coat the leaves. And the most effective way to spray this onto your plant is to hit the bottom of the leaves. And the plant will absorb it immediately, right away. If you're doing a soil drench, you basically apply about 4 times more than you would have in a spray as a soil drench. And this is also going to stimulate the microorganisms that are living in the soil. And as they become stimulated, they're communicating with the plant and giving the plant what it needs. And as you stimulate that micro ecosystem, they can help the plant and help it even better than you can. Also, here in Hawaii, it's not that much of an issue, but if you live in an area that frosts over, you can spray the OHN, and it'll help you where your neighbor will lose their crop to a frost. If you spray this OHN, you won't, unless it really freezes. You know, like, but a snap frost that we can get, you can apply the OHN, and that same heat that it brings, it just stimulates the whole microecology that they're moving around. They're like, man, did you get some of that? Yeah, that was good. That you won't lose it to a frost.
The alcohol is an antifreeze.
The alcohol probably helps, but once you've diluted it to 1 to 1,000, the alcohol is so minute that it's really the nutrients that are in there that is the main acting factor.
Would you spray? How often would you recommend spraying on a healthy plant or drenching?
Common application is every 7 to 11 days as a maintenance. So once a week.
Did you say you're mixing this with the vinegar, or is it just straight? This solution when you spray it on the plant?
As a maintenance spray, which is like you can just use it by itself, and that's great. There's also in Korean natural farming, there's what we call the maintenance spray, which consists of this vinegar as well as the fermented plant juice. I know some people here aren't familiar with the vocabulary I'm using here, but those are some of our amendments that we use.
Okay.
And like I said, I haven't been sick for 5 years, and what I do is anytime I feel a scratchy throat, or I feel like I'm around people that are sick, or, you know, right now I got my friend is visiting and she has like a little 6-month-old kid, and she has like this cough, and it's kind of gross. And so I've just been dosing on my version of the OHN. You know, anytime I'm walking by my kitchen, I just like squirt a little bit in my mouth, and just to keep myself up and boosted, so that I'm not getting sick. And well, it's actually on the, I guess I kind of have my slides out of order here, but the really nice thing about this OHN and this medicine is that you can use it regularly. Like I could literally take a little bit every half hour, and I'm not gonna build up a resistance. Like some medicines you take, and then like you need to take it while you're sick, otherwise you're gonna, you know, it's not as effective. But this can be used preemptively, and it can be used, you know, regularly, and it's still gonna have the same effectiveness. Because these herbs are getting like into your cells, and they're really just stimulating your body to work more. It's not, you know, it's like optimizing you as a way to like be medicine. Like you're so healthy, you can't get sick. And as a property of tincturing, and the cool thing about the way we've done this here is that by doing our fermentation first, we've unlocked all those cells, and the microorganisms have gotten in there, and they've sort of pre-digested the material, but they weren't able to solubilize certain nutrients. And so when we add, it's like the door is open, and then when we add the alcohol, then the nutrients go into the solution and become water soluble. So as opposed to just taking fresh herbs and mixing the alcohol into them, if you ferment them first with our sugar, or you reconstitute them with that beer, it helps to open them up so they're ready to be even more potent in your alcohol extraction method. Also, alcohol can make many nutrients that wouldn't otherwise be water soluble, especially up at that 35%. Whereas sometimes in our other natural farming, we do fermentation and it creates alcohol, but it's around maybe like 0.5% to 3%. When you're up at 35%, it solubilizes a whole different range of nutrients that aren't soluble. But then basically most nutrients are only soluble in alcohol, is the way I understand it. So whether it's fermenting inside of you, or you're fermenting it externally and then taking it internally, it's the fermentation method that is making the nutrients soluble and then moving them into your cells. Because if a nutrient is not soluble, it will not enter your cell. So solubilizing and then using the alcohol. And alcohol is also much more aggressive at entering and breaching that cell boundary. So if I got a chunk of garlic that's bound with this alcohol molecule, it's going to enter into that cell really aggressively. You know, that's how you get drunk so fast, is like alcohol is just like, oh man, it hits you hard, you know? And so that's the mechanism of what's happening there. And this is just off the internet. If you search for tinctures, you'll find this guy. So what are the benefits? Like, why would I want to use it? It's because it helps to rapidly return to aerobic conditions. Majority of the pathogens or disease-causing organisms that we face live and thrive in anaerobic conditions, meaning without oxygen. They're just going to party, party, party. But if you can apply OHN it helps to rapidly bring oxygen back in. Just like you felt that kind of burn through you, what's really happening is you're oxidizing, and you're literally like burning on the inside as you're oxidizing. And so it helps to bring that oxygen through into and restore conditions. So if you're turning a compost pile and you want it to stay aerobic, so you're growing good microbes, you can spray some OHN diluted 1:1,000 for your water that you're going to add to get your moisture content. And that's going to help the pile stay aerobic, because it's going to help that oxygen happen.
Oxygen
was bad. That's why we do eat things that are antioxidants, like blueberries and tea. In certain parts of your body, yes. In other parts of your body, no. So, it also helps fermentation happen faster, yet it's more controlled. Meaning that the good microbes are going to really thrive, but the bad guys are going to have a hard time taking off because it's such an aerobic thing. So that the guys that love oxygen and love the aerobic conditions are really going to take off fast and speed up your fermentation process, but the bad guys aren't going to take over. So it's cool for helping that. And like I've been saying, it really selects for our beneficial microorganisms. Certain pathogens and other things, in the presence of the OHN, garlic, is classically sold as like antifungal, right? I mean, you probably heard that garlic is antifungal. What they're really saying is that it's anti-bad fungal, because it keeps the good fungus there. Because you want good fungus in your body and in your environment. But the garlic will get rid of the bad stuff. I'm not exactly sure how that mechanism works, but and as I was saying before, I thought this was on the previous slide, but basically you can take it all the time and you're not going to build up resistance. Which that's one of the coolest things with a medicine. Because a lot of other things, you take it and then you're vulnerable. Like if you take too much Echinacea, then it boosts your immune system, but then it drops it down lower when you're not sick. And in this case, if you just did OHN, you're gonna just boost yourself and stay boosted. You're not gonna ever have that kind of crash from this. And also the longer it sits, the more potent it gets. So when you make it and you have it sitting around, it's actually appreciating asset?
Yes.
So it's a good investment. You make it today and it's gonna get more valuable tomorrow, which how many things does that happen with? And for those of you that don't know, this is it's a picture of Master Cho here. He's the guy that I learned this stuff from and visited in Korea. And if you're a Korean natural farmer, you get to have his little nice logo at your farm. And what he's doing there with his hands like this is that's the Korean way of saying I love you. So now that we're all cool with that, kind of went through what our OHN is. I've also learned from a few other people on what you can do and use in these situations. So I call that mixture there that you guys all had a chance to sample, I call it Hawaiian herbal nutrient. And it's garlic, ginger, and turmeric in there. One of the cool properties that I heard about turmeric is that viruses cannot replicate in the presence of turmeric. So whatever the curcumin or whatever the, don't quote me on that, whatever the, like the potency of turmeric is it, I don't know. Yeah, maybe it's that or whatever. But viruses cannot replicate in the presence of it. So if you're sick and you start taking the OHN with turmeric, you're not going to get sicker. The virus is going to be like stopped, and your immune system then just has to purge what you have out of you. It's not going to keep replicating. So I'm sure you guys can probably think of a few diseases that that would be nice for. And when I, there's another natural farmer that came to Hawaii in 2009, and his name is Gil Karangai, and I highly recommend you look him up, he's a great guy. But what he does is he makes just garlic ginger, and then he'll take from the cashew, when you pull the, you got the cashew and then the actual nut is at the bottom, you pull that off, that white sap stuff that comes out, he'll tincture this garlic and ginger, the way I talked about in the OHN, and then he'll add that cashew sap into it. And this is his medicine that he uses. And you can research more on the cashew itself, but it has... So research more before you eat this evening. But this is just hearsay at this point on this topic. Everything else was experience. I've done it.
What was Bill's last name again?
Only parts of the cashew fruit trees are poisonous. Like it's medicinal, some parts are medicinal. It's like the sour tree. It's like some parts of it are poisonous.
Yeah, what's the heat? It's the sap that comes out when you break the nut off that he's using. So, but that, again, hearsay on that, please. Be safe. Yes.
Drake, on the Hawaiian modification, is it just those three, not those three plus the other ones? It's just a tincture made with those three, yeah?
Yeah, and reason for me is that, you know what, you feel free to mix those other ones in there, but for me to get, I didn't have access to the other stuff. This stuff, I can go down to the Hilo Farmer's Market,
fresh,
and it's all there. Yeah. You know, I can start today. I can make this recipe, whereas to get the cinnamon, you know, like the first time we did it, we ordered it, it came from New York City. Yeah, and then gelatin. But there was a woman here years ago that was growing it in Pahoa, of the Angelica that we have, but I haven't heard back from her or know what's up, but I know Angelica can be grown here and is available on the island. And cinnamon trees are really easy to grow. It takes a long time, but set it and forget it kind of thing. And I'm really not sure the licorice pie. Anyone have experience with licorice plant?
I don't think
so. Okay.
It's a rooster.
So, yeah. So, getting close to time to eat. So, I just want to go through and talk about a little bit of other tinctures that I've made and that I actually have here for sample. But these can be sent around. And this one in my left hand here is made from mugwort. And this one in my right hand is made from comfrey. So
you use weed or leaf of the
compost? I use the leaf. Yep. The root I was a little skeptical on because of conflicting stuff. I believe it would be safe, especially if it was fermented first before, which these were fermented first. I made a fermented plant juice, which that's another recipe, it's on the internet. And then I tinctured them.
So with whatever ingredients you're using, it's making it, the ingredient, when it already has a benefit, you're basically making it more beneficial, right?
So the question was if it's beneficial by tincturing, I'm making it more beneficial?
I guess, like whatever it does that's good for you, is it just making it more usable, essentially?
So what I'm doing is I'm solubilizing these compounds or whatever they are, solubilizing it so that then it can enter into your cell.
Right.
Because if I did not tincture this, it would just float by my cell, and my cell would be like, oh, I'm not interested. But because it has the alcohol, it's just like, wham, take it.
So in other words, the more times you reduce it, the better it is?
These here, the mugwort and the comfrey, this is the first pour off. I did not go through this four times to pour these off. This was just I fermented it first, I poured off the liquid that came out, and then I filled it up with alcohol to the brim of my jar.
So if there's like an herb that is known for doing something, could you create your own recipe with whatever herbs you might need for yourself?
Yeah.
Take care of whatever it is that you're trying to do.
Yeah, absolutely. So if you know it to yourself, you already have some beneficial herb that you're privy to. Yeah, this process will work with, I'm pretty sure, almost anything. Right? I'm pretty sure you can ferment anything, and I'm pretty sure you can tincture anything.
Cool. Just to back up, so when we were talking about making the original fermentation, using a dry material, you're putting it in the beer when you do the fermentation. You don't pour the beer off and then put the alcohol on, you put the alcohol right on top of the beer.
Absolutely. Yes. So, reason I tinctured the mugwort and the comfrey is I'm really trying to heal my teeth and take the best care of them throughout my life. And so, I'm using calcium phosphate, water soluble calcium phosphate that I have, because that's super important for bone and health. And then, mugwort, when I was in Korea, as just kind of an aside, while we're at this learning center, Master Cho's daughter started to talk about the mugwort soju, is what they called it, which is just a mugwort tincture. And so she was saying that basically you can pull the toxins out of your bones. Your bones are kind of like sponges, and somehow the mugwort, I've heard before that mugwort was used to like cleanse water, like biblically, I think it's in the Bible, of using mugwort when they were in the desert to clear the water so they could drink it. And so what it's doing is it's a toxin like aggregator, like gets like cleans things out. And so when you tincture it, it can really help to pull things out of your bones. And she also said that it's an extremely strong fungal control. So if you're looking at your plant and it has some kind of fungus attacking it, you can dilute this again 1 to 1,000, spray it on, and it's going to help to mitigate that fungus. And this is, again, hearsay, but I'm living experiment right now trying it. So far it's worked. And comfrey is known as bone knit. So you break a bone, it knits it. And so I thought to myself, well, I'll make a fermented plant juice out of it, and I'll make a tincture out of it, and I'll combine both those, and I'll drink it, maybe my teeth will get better. Yeah, they don't bleed anymore.
Is there any topical application, or is it strictly internal?
I believe you can do it topically as well. I'm actually in an experiment with my friend right now who's a gymnast and has messed up her fingers, and so we're doing topical on her hands to see how that affects it. And so far, she's had less pain, but she continually re-injures it, so it's kind of hard. And also, Comfrey has allotone in it. Google that and I'll show you how to spell it or say it properly. And what that does is your body has receptors for it, but you no longer produce it. And so when your body, your receptors get stimulated by this allotonin, you basically go into superhuman healing mode. And they'll warn you against putting Comfrey onto an open wound because the skin can heal over so fast that it may seal an infection inside. So you just go into really fast healing mode when you have Comfrey around. So I figured, why not tincture it and see if that'll work? And I use the leaves here. I believe you could use the root, but
the root has more of the allotropin than the leaf.
But also the root on the internet has more where it's like it may or may not affect your liver.
Right.
And I'm like,
right. But that's when people
I like my
drink
liver.
When they drink tea in it. So like tincture would be.
Yeah.
If you were going to use it for plants, I would probably maybe try the root.
Okay. I also just, I don't have too much Comfrey growing around right now, so I just use the leaf, because the leaf grows back really fast, because they don't want to pick up the plant. But that's just my own story.
Does the mugwort grow around here, or is that something?
Yes, and this is a picture of it right here. You may see it. It's a common weed in pepper kale. It's, it seems to be pretty resistant to Roundup. It grows right on the side of the road.
Roundup,
right?
It
came by natural selection.
Kind of puts out a stem like that with little white
genetic
flowers on it. It would kind of be around. I probably should have brought cuttings of it. It's super easy to grow. You just stick it in the ground, and then it's like mint. It will just go everywhere. Why did I plant that there?
Good ground cover.
So plant it, you know, where you're gonna, in the bushes.
It used to be all the roadside field, but it hasn't come back to me after the roundup. All the roadside.
Is it on the basic leaflets?
No, because it doesn't really spread. It just it's like a running bamboo. It's not gonna like go over there and spread. I don't think it's invasive. Plus, it's a common weed, so.
The general attack of plants, so you disturb soil. That's why you see it on the roadside.
Yeah, and to follow up on that comment, the majority of the things you see growing where the soil's been disturbed tend to be really medicinal plants, because what they're trying to do is to heal that section of the earth. So if you go to where, you know, you see where it's completely destroyed and there's like those weeds, ferment and tincture those for your medicines here.
Would you use like some of these for chickens in their water, really diluted?
Yes, that's something I did not include in here, but that as a animal stimulant, like if you see your animal and it's obvious they got like an upset stomach, or they're not healthy, or they're not eating as much as they usually do, you can include the OHN in their water. And just like how it heals you, it will also have great effect on the animals and kind of revitalize them, help their digestion, bring them back to life a little bit.
In the dilution of 1 to 1,000, added to the water?
Yeah, and at 1 to 700 at the most.
Okay.
I mean, it's not going to kill them to have it straight up, but if they're already sick, you don't like 1 to 700 is about it.
What do you do with the leftover material?
Compost. Yeah, at this point, because I've already kind of gone through, composting is probably the best next step for this.
So there's so much sugar in it, does that attract varmints?
It grew in the landfill.
The sugar goes with the alcohol.
Yeah, no, it. I haven't seen adverse effects. I put it into my compost. I actually have a little bokashi bucket that I do, and I put it right in there. It seems like I put lactic acid bacteria in there, and it seems to just digest everything pretty soon. And then I'll put soldier flies in there. So, okay, so two more slides here. So this is just a suggested workflow here of that I actually got from Lynn last time she was here, where she was talking about how she was doing her tinctures and her ferments, and I thought to myself, well, that's great. And so if you follow the natural farming recipe to make fermented plant juice, and you make your fermented plant juice, typically what you're going to do is add equal parts of sugar to make sure that you've arrested the fermentation and it no longer continues to break down. So by adding equal amounts of sugar, I can stop fermentation. The other way to stop fermentation is to add alcohol into there. So either my osmotic pressure from the sugar is too high for the microbes to live, or there's too much alcohol that they can no longer reproduce. And so my thinking on that is that I make my fermented plant juice and I just put it in my fridge to kind of cool the temperature down so the microbes don't keep, they're just hibernate. And then I'll tincture that material. So I've already done my first fermentation step of that. Then I fill it up with alcohol and I tincture it out. Then I'll pour both of those together into the FPJ. And now I've got the alcohol content high enough that I've arrested the fermentation so that further decomposition doesn't happen and I preserve those at that step. And if you're pulling out the nutrients via just a sugar fermentation with a small alcohol content, you're gonna get certain nutrients. And then when you tincture it with this higher alcohol content, you're gonna get these other nutrients. And so you combine them both together and now you're getting all the nutrients, right? At least that was my idea. modification of someone else's idea that I was like, that's a good one. Also, if you look for medicine on the internet, you'll find this.
You could take that one step further, and you could take the end material, you know, your plant material after you've fermented it, and add water to bring out the components that are soluble in your water, and then add that in your dilution. So because it's going to be a whole other complement of nutrients that come out of the water.
So once you're done, you've done a fermented plant juice, you've done a tincture, now you take your material and instead of composting or throwing in the landfill like we're talking about, you add water into that and let it sit for probably, 7 days or so?
Yeah.
7 to 10 days, that will then get a different set of nutrients and things that like water into it. And then keep that over here, and when I'm going to make my batch for my plant and I'm diluting this 1 to 1,000 into it, now I'm gonna take this and also add that in. And so I'm getting nutrients from all sides into this and then I'm gonna apply that to my plant. Modify this line. Sweet stock photography degree. So if you want more information on this, there's a really nice info sheet put out by the UH that is at this URL here. And it's this right here, so. So this this is Natural Farming Oriental Herbal Nutrient. Kim Chang was in the back. Joe McGinlin, that's my other name. And Mike DuPont's back there. So also the authors are here in this room, and this is a official document on this and So it just kind of explains to you the steps of what's going through. And you can see here dilutions and things. And so, so I hope you guys enjoy kind of my explanation of this. Sometimes I feel it's nice to kind of hear it in person and to hear this, even though this information is online. What we try to do here is every month I try to go over one of the recipes. And in fact, the last bit I have been. And so, thank you. So before we get to if there's any further questions, I guess you can come up and see me. Or does anyone have any burning questions right now? Okay. And then we'll go eat, take this time to talk story, get to know different people, and thank you. Okay, so if you don't know it, I typed it on here, it's up here. Exactly like. Microbes below and bringing that wisdom right here to where we're at.
That's the treasure.